Wild Awakening, How a Raging Grizzly Healed My Wounded Heart, by Greg J. Matthews, with James Lund, in the author's own words.
This is dedicated to you, Dad, my best friend, my brother Matt, the hero, and my anchors, my wife Rhea, and my kids Casey, Benjamin, and Sierra, who gave me the strength to survive. Prologue. Razor-sharp fangs plunge into my side and lift me 4 feet into the air. The pain is excruciating. I'm slammed onto the ground, but those daggers don't loosen their grip. I'm dragged over dead limbs, leaves, dirt. My fingers dig trenches in the soil, but my efforts fail to halt our deadly progress. A river of red fills one of the furrows in the dirt behind me. It's blood, my blood. I'm at the mercy of a monster. Where is this thing taking me? I'm sliding into the abyss of irreversible shock. I've lost my voice. My strength to fight is all but gone. I think of my wife Rhea and my kids Casey, Ben, and Sierra. Then I think of God, the one I've entrusted with my life, the one who has always come through for me until now. Lord, how can you let this happen? I want to see my family again. Please make it stop. Suddenly I am released. Where is it? Using up what little reserve I have left, I lift my head. Mere inches away, angry coal-black eyes stare into mine. Hot, foul-smelling breath washes over me. My ears fill with the sound of a low, rumbling growl. For just an instant, I catch the glint of white fangs as they lunge from my throat. With a jerk of terror, I sit up. I'm in a bed, gasping for air, covered in sweat. Darkness surrounds me. Where am I? Is this a nightmare or is it real? What is happening to me? Chapter 1, Sunshine and Storm. Mario Balotelli said, "They say that abandonment is a wound that never heals. I say only that an abandoned child never forgets." I took a few stealthy steps and stopped. With each breath, white puffs rose from my lips into the crisp morning air. Ahead of me, stretching to rolling hills in the distance, was a mostly desolate landscape dotted with sagebrush, cactus, and sand as far as the eye could see. I was in the sprawling Mojave Desert. My grip tightened on the rifle in my hands, and I slowly turned my head, straining my eyes for the slightest sign of movement. I was on a safari, a mighty hunter at last. It was December 27, 1974. I was nearly 8 years old. My weapon was a brand new Marlin 22. My quarry was the mighty jackrabbit. I trembled with excitement. How many hours, on how many nights, had I lain in the upper berth of my bunk bed at home, staring at the posters of deer and bears I'd put up on my wall, imagining this day. Yet the best part wasn't being in the outdoors or the anticipation of hunting game for the first time, though each of these was a prize in itself. Nope, the real reward was sharing this moment with the broad-shouldered man who stood next to me, Dad. Roger Matthews, son of a World War II Air Force veteran, was a former Marine infantryman who these days wore the beige uniform of a California Highway Patrol officer. He was an imposing figure, 6'1", with an athletic build, a military haircut, and gray eyes that often seemed to bore through you. In many ways, he led his family, my mom Elizabeth and my younger brother Shane, age 6, and Matt, age 3, the way a sergeant might lead his platoon. When Dad told you to do something, there was no discussion or negotiation, and you'd better be getting started by the time he finished telling you. You addressed his friends and acquaintances as sir. If you weren't 15 minutes early, you were late. Good manners were required at all times. Dad wasn't mean, and we weren't in boot camp, but the sense of military structure was undeniable. To me, this was simply who my father was. His disciplined approach to life and our family made perfect sense to him and to me. It was one of the things that enabled him to do a dangerous job. Each time my father walked out of the house in the morning, that 7-point gold badge on his chest and pistol holstered at his side, I nearly burst with pride. He was a man who could handle himself. A man who took on the bad guys each day and won. A man people could count on. He was my hero. I wanted to be just like him. By the time of our rabbit hunt in the desert, Dad had spent 3 years teaching me gun safety, how to aim, and how to clean a rifle. I'd already joined him on many hunts for quail and jackrabbits. Some days he'd pick me up early from kindergarten in his bright red Ford Bronco, drive out to a ravine on the backside of Big Bear Lake, and set up beside some boulders. My job was spotter and retriever. When I saw a flight of doves coming into range, I alerted Dad, who shot the birds out of the sky. I then ran into the bush to retrieve the doves and drop them into a hunting vest. We'd do that until dark. I was more like the hunting dog than the hunter, but I didn't mind. I loved those outings, just Dad and me and the great outdoors. Sometime during the last few months, I decided I was old enough to hunt with Dad using a rifle of my own. Every Saturday that fall, I walked to the local library and pored over the latest editions of Field and Stream, Outdoor Life, and Sports Afield magazines. I was searching for my weapon of choice, a Marlin 22 semi-automatic with a clip. I thought if I found one on sale, it would be easier to convince Dad to buy me one for Christmas. I'd already made my wishes known. My Christmas list had only 2 items, the Marlin rifle and a box of ammo. I'd set my heart on getting that rifle. I was like Ralphie, the boy who longed for a Red Ryder BB gun in the movie A Christmas Story. I'm amazed no one told me I'd shoot my eye out. But Dad never gave me the slightest hint that he was thinking about it. Whenever I brought it up, he'd say, "Well, I'm not sure about that yet." By Christmas Eve, I'd pretty much resigned myself to disappointment. It seemed the Marlin was not in my future. I tossed and turned in my bed that night. The numbers on the digital clock on my nightstand seemed frozen in place. I finally fell asleep at 2 a.m., then woke up 3 hours later. Fearing the worst, but no longer able to contain myself, I crept down the dark hallway and into a room shimmering with Christmas magic. My eyes first took in the 5 stockings tacked to the fireplace mantle, the material stretched and bulging from goodies hidden inside. Below, a gas fire was already glowing. Then I swept my gaze to the left and saw our Christmas tree, which was decorated with shining multicolored lights and surrounded by a mountain of presents. I quickly scanned the pile of packages. I knew the shape I was looking for, only it wasn't there. But when I stepped forward and looked behind the tree, I saw it. A long, slender box leaned against the wall. Could it be? I hurried over to inspect the tag. It read, "From Santa." But who was it for? This has to be it, I thought. But if it's not, it must be mine, but maybe it isn't. My emotions bounced back and forth like a ping pong ball. Every year, Dad insisted that we kids open our biggest Christmas presents last. After everyone got up, I unwrapped a dozen packages, but my eyes never strayed long from that tall present. Finally, Dad grinned and said the words I'd been waiting to hear. "Greg, that box against the wall is for you." I tore off the paper and found exactly what I had dreamed of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.